各位嘉宾，各位朋友们，大家好，我是中国国际科技合作协会科技外交专家委员会主任季永明，很荣幸作为我们科学与外交国际论坛圆桌对话的主持人。刚刚呢，孙建副司长介绍了国际科技合作倡议，提出倡导并践行开放、公平、公正、非歧视的国际科技合作理念，坚持科学无国界，惠及全人类，坚持科研诚信，尊重科研伦理，塑造科技向善理念，这正是本场论坛的主题。下面我介绍一下今天参加圆桌对话的各位嘉宾。第一位是凤麟和团队，国际合作部部长，中巴医学协会会长穆罕默德·沙巴兹先生。第二位是中国科学院古脊椎动物和古人类研究所助理研究员保罗·拉米先生。第三位是中国热带农业科学院副教授、高级研究员瓦利德·福阿德·穆罕默德·吉丹先生。第四位是我们中国科学院理化技术研究所研究员、中法低温计量科学与技术国际联合实验室副主任高波女士。第五位是外交学院亚洲研究所讲师王东女士。那么我们本次圆桌对话的主题是促进科学向善，助力可持续发展。2021年9月24日呢，习近平主席在中关村论坛的视频致辞中首次提出了科技向善的理念。他指出，当今世界发展科学技术必须具有全球视野，把握时代脉搏，紧扣人类生产生活提出的新要求。中国高度重视科技创新，致力于推动全球科技创新协作，将以更加开放的态度加强国际科技交流，营造一流的创新生态，铸造科技向善理念，完善全球科技治理，更好地增进人类福祉。下面呢，我们就请各位专家分别从各自专业角度分享如何理解科学向善的内涵和外延，以及科学向善如何助力可持续发展。期待各位专家发表真知灼见，请各位专家发言控制在5分钟之内。那么我现在有请来自巴基斯坦的穆罕默德·沙巴兹先生，他是凤麟和团队国际合作部的部长，中巴医学协会的会长，中国巴基斯坦健康走廊项目创始人兼首席执行官，丝绸之路友谊大使，世卫组织传统医学基金会执行董事。请沙巴兹先生，请您分享对于科学向善助力可持续发展的深刻理解。
Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, diplomats, leaders of Ministry of Science and Technology of People's Republic of China, China Association for International Science and Technology Cooperation, Beijing Municipal Science and Technology Commission, Administrative Commission of Chongguansun Science Park, ladies and gentlemen, Dajia Nihao, Assalamu Alaikum and good afternoon. As chairman of China-Pakistan Health Corridor and president of China-Pakistan Medical Association and head of international cooperation at FTS Consortium, I feel immense pleasure to address at the round table session. And I'm honored to be able to come to Beijing for this wonderful event organized by Ministry of Science and Technology, and I can't help admiring the dynamic perspective of this event, which has gathered us all here to create many opportunities for our future cooperation. As the theme of this session mentions, promoting science for good, supporting the sustainable development in the intricate weave of global challenges, the threat of innovation and sustainable development form a tapestry that tells the story of progress and resilience. The urgency of sustainable socio-economic uplift, particularly in the global south, hinges on the transformative influence of science, technology, and innovation. The resonant theme of innovation and sustainable development not only captures the spirit of our times, but also addresses the pressing issues of population explosion, climate change, food insecurity, and deepening the divide between prosperity and poverty. In the crucible of today's competitive global environment, the call for sustainable solutions has never been more pressing. Governments, multinational corporations, and small and medium enterprises acknowledge the pivotal role of innovation as catalyst for change and development. The fourth industrial revolution, encapsulated in the Industry 4.0, enhances the potential of science, technology, innovation to steer the sustainable development. I feel great pleasure that as the president of China-Pakistan Medical Association, I've been playing the key role for the establishment of multidisciplinary cooperation in the medical field between China and Pakistan and Belt and Road countries. As the ambassador of Silk Road Friendship, it's worthy to mention that our organization is one of the essential platform for bridging the gap between the two countries and the Belt and Road countries. In the healthcare sector, China-Pakistan Health Corridor is a state-of-the-art initiative by the China-Pakistan Medical Association, which consists of multidisciplinary interconnected groups of hospitals, medical universities, institutions, and research and training centers along the Belt and Road countries. The CPSC aligns with the Sustainable Development Goal 3.0, which emphasizes the importance of good health and well-being. By sharing expertise and adopting the best practices, this initiative contributes significantly to building a resilient healthcare infrastructure that can withstand current and future challenges. Our team at FTS Consortium, Department of International Cooperation, is for promoting the health and well-being of the people of the Belt and Road countries through technical innovation in high-end precise tumor radiation therapy, and also under the leadership of our academician Wu Yisen at the International Academy of Neutron Sciences, working for the safety and sustainable energy. The experience of China in managing the health crisis can be invaluable for other countries, especially those involved in the Belt and Road. The President Xi's vision for coordinated national response can be a model for the BRI countries to strengthen their healthcare system. The collaboration can lead to the development of robust healthcare infrastructure, ensuring that BRI countries are better prepared for healthcare emergencies, and they can provide the quality healthcare facilities for their citizens. Joint efforts in research and development can accelerate the discovery of vaccines, treatment facilities, diagnostic tools, fostering the innovation in the field of public health. The initiative not only enhances the healthcare landscape between Pakistan, but also strengthen the friendship between Pakistan and China. As the corridor continues to evolve, its impact on the healthcare sector and beyond is poised to be a beacon of success in Sino-Pak relations. At the end, I would like to say, long live China-Pakistan friendship, Chao Pa Yu Yi Ban Sui. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. 中巴健康走廊作为多学科合作平台，通过远程医疗和人工智能等手段，促进了两国医疗卫生领域的合作，有助于构建强健的医疗保健基础设施，实现双赢合作，为我们带来了很大的启发。那么下面我们有请来自马来西亚的保罗拉米先生，他是古生物与地层学博士，中国科学院古脊椎动物和古人类研究所助理研究员，主要研究中生代恐龙及半生动物物群，古生物遗迹等。有请您阐述科学向善如何积极影响并推动可持续发展的进程。
谢谢各位尊敬的领导们嘉宾和朋友们下午好。So basically, my topic today, so let me give the speech in English, all right? Okay. So I work on museum. So I've been working on nature history subject for half of my life. So my topic today will be on the past and the new productive forces, museum roles in advancing the sustainable development goals and popularizing of science. So if you translate this into Mandarin, it's 远古迹与新智生产力，当博物馆在推动可持续发展和科学普及中的作用。So as we know that China is currently transitioning into a new phase of growth, emphasizing on high quality development. However, in light of the global economic slowdown, China must also cultivate the new drivers of growth. This does not imply on neglecting the traditional industry. So, the new productive forces is a new term. Yeah? It's a new term which refers to innovative approaches and technologies that can enhance productivity and drive sustainable development. Museums, traditionally seen as preserve culture and history, are increasingly playing roles in advancing the SDGs, which are a set of global goals aimed at addressing pressing social, economic, and environmental challenges. So, taking the words of President Xi from his recent visit to Nanjing Museum, we must do a good job in the museum industry. Museum construction should be more perfect and systematic, and the educational function of museums should be fully utilized. So, over the past couple of years, my work on research, excavation, and educational purposes has brought me to many places in China. So it involved with collaboration with many schools, particularly Nature History Museum, as well as with school students and the community. So in relation to today's topic, I see the two crucial aspects where both museums and popular science can contribute to the advancing of SDGs and open science. So museum can contribute to achieving SDGs in various ways, okay? So museum, there's a lot of museum of various fields in the world. So museum can also promote sustainable practices in their operation. So most importantly, museum can contribute to popularizing of science. So how can museum contribute to SDGs? First, through education and awareness, okay? Second, preservation of cultural and heritage. And third, promotion of sustainable practices. Fourth, advocacy and partnership. And the last one, which my work mostly involved, was the engagement with community, for example, outreach program, where as a scientist, you have to interpret your results to the community, because your articles will not be understood by the community. So popular science is one way to promote sciences to the community. So this is one way that my work is involved through the last couple of years, which I've enjoyed. So popular science is something that we emphasize a lot. And as a scientist, we must always learn how to convert our results so that everyone could understand what we are doing. So this is a way that it contributes to open science engagement. So that's all from me. Thank you.
好，感谢保罗·拉米先生的精彩的分享。那么博物馆作为文化和历史的保存者，在推动可持续发展目标方面发挥越来越重要的作用，并更加完善和系统化的建设。那么科普在社会中扮演着重要的角色，帮助公众理解科学知识，提高对重要科学问题的认识。感谢拉米先生为我们提供的丰富经验和深刻的见解，谢谢。
谢谢。
下面我们有请来自埃及的瓦利德·福阿德·穆罕默德·吉德安先生，他是中国热带农业科学院水稻育种及分子生物学高级研究员、副教授，云南省农业科学院前副教授。那么青年科学家人才，埃及农业研究中心大田作物研究所水稻研究及培训中心的研究人员，负责水稻杂交种质交换及生物这个技术的项目。我们现在有请吉丹先生，探讨科学向善如何助力可持续发展。有请吉丹先生。
Thank you very much for your kind of work. So let me to just share small topics about my speech. And first, I think we are together today and maybe a little separate in the topics, but I guess we will share maybe in one or two points together. So, ladies and gentlemen, the production of knowledge and information through science is a means to help us find solutions to the major economic, social, and environmental challenges we face today, and a means to achieve sustainable development and build greener societies. The primary objective at present is to identify and promote significant opportunities and partnership that will leverage science and academia to accelerate progress in key areas of the next plan by bringing together policymakers, researchers, academics, and various stakeholders. The event aims to promote dialogue, share best practices, and develop actionable strategies for shared prosperity. Until the present day, in despite of significant scientific support for the sustainable development goals, progress has been slow so far. It is now necessary to work hard to bring these gaps and enhance responsible use of science, technology, and innovation as drivers the sustainable development in line with the commitments in the political declaration of SDG. The critical role that science, technology, and innovation play in addressing sustainable challenges is clear. However, achieving tangible progress requires more than just scientific progress. It requires strong interface between science, policy, and society that guides the creation making at all levels. In order to make this easier, we must leave behind the traditional competitive and segregation theories of scientific research for sustainability and adopt a new way of thinking. We must virtualize the generation of actionable knowledge that lead to practice results. Just as the global community has used scientific methods of building infrastructure, a similar mentality must be applied to address sustainable development challenges. As someone who's been working in the field of agricultural research for several years, there is no way to retreat now from the implementation of applied agricultural research. in different productive environments for the purpose of developing the region of the best agricultural trades, just seed region to increase productivity and the food security in light of our limited resource of land, water, and of course, large population increase. Through the promoting science for good and supporting sustainable development, it's necessary to establish a unique platform to advocate and support mission-oriented, multidisciplinary science and an ambitious framework to catalyze collective efforts toward a better future. Finally, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to the Minister of Science and Technology and the Beijing Municipal People Government for hosting the International Forum of Science and Diplomacy and for promoting an excellent dialogue that inspires all to the future. I also extend all my thanks and appreciation to all my Chinese colleagues and friends for their constant support for me while I work with them and for help and guidance during difficult time, which was very useful and invaluable that all subversible attitudes made every working day enjoyable. I am grateful for the moment we spent together, the memories we made together, which making China is not a place to live in, but a place to live in us. Thank you very much for your attention.
科学和技术在解决我们今天面临的经济社会和环境挑战中起着关键的作用，也是实现可持续发展和建设更绿色社会的重要手段。那么当前需要识别和推广重大的机会和合作伙伴关系，利用科学和学术界来加速下一个计划的关键领域的进步。您的经验对我们来说是非常宝贵的学习资源。 那么下面我们有请高波女士，发表意见。那么她是中国科学院理化技术研究所正高级工程师，低温科学与技术重点实验室中国科学院主任，中法低温计量科学与技术国际联合实验室副主任，亚洲科学院及学会协会杰出青年女科学家。 国际温度咨询委员会杰出测温工作组特邀专家，中国计量测试学会理事，北京女科技工作者协会理事。那么，高女士将为我们揭示科学向善如何助力社会的可持续发展。有请高女士。
好，谢谢郑主任。尊敬的各位嘉宾，下午好。那么呢，接下来呢？ 我将结合自己的专业领域，然后结合咱们的议题呢，提出一点自己的这个理解。那么，我所从事呢是一个非常非常小众、冷门的领域，那有多冷呢？是低于零下153度。那么它是就是低温温度计量。我的工作呢就是在这么低的温度范围内，然后把这个温度 测准，并且呢，实现在全世界范围内的量值统一，大概就是做这样的工作。那么，2018年呢，这个整个计量领域呢，面临着一个重大的历史性变革。大家所熟知的七个基本物理量的单位，像这个时间的单位秒、长度的单位米、质量单位千克，当然包括我们热力学温度的单位开尔文等等啊。 以前呢，由看得见摸得着的实际的物体来定义，现在呢，将由常数来定义。这个呢，是被誉为是自法国大革命以来，就是在全球范围内统一的度量衡以来，这个计量史上最伟大的变革。那么我们这个一方面呢，如何确定这个单位，也就是确定刻度；另一方面呢，如何基于新的定义，根据刻度 建立呢丈量其他物理量的这几个物理量的尺子，这个呢是科学全世界的科学家们共同逼近测量极限的一个过程，也是在这一科基础的科学领域，就是科学家们所面临的共同挑战。就正如咱们那个习近平总书记说的，就人类要在破解共同发展的难题的时候，我们比以往更需要国际合作和开放共享。在这样的这个背景下，我们在科技部、科学院还有北京市的这个以及使领馆的这个项目人才平台一体化的这个前瞻性布局的帮助下，建立了中法联合实验室。不仅仅呢在单位定义的时候呢取得了国际上最好的结果，并且呢在单位实施的时候呢，我们基于自己原创的原理，建立了在-248度到-268度这个温区呢，就是测量温度最准的一把尺子。不仅仅呢建立了咱们国家这个温度的这个量值源头，并且呢就是向国际同行贡献了最优的数据，也就是中国温度。截止到目前呢，它的结果都是最好的，并且呢，在此呢，也特别感谢科技部和这个北京市提供的机会。我们的相关工作呢，也在13.5成果展上，还有这个中关村论坛上给党和国家领导人做了汇报。这不仅仅是对我们工作的认可，也是对国际合作工作的认可。回首过去呢，其实我们是国际合作的这个受益者。但是展望未来呢，我们面临着新的机遇和挑战，就是特别是在这个国家实验室体系重组的过程中呢，我们呢也有幸建立了低温科学与技术重点实验室，并且呢，就是已经接近筹备的这个尾声，今年呢会向这个科技部申报全国重点实验室。未来呢，我们将继续秉承促进科学向善、助力可持续发展的这个理念，开展呢更大范围、更深层次的广泛的科技合作，并且呢，将相应的科技创新成果呢，惠及人类，我们尽一点绵薄之力。谢谢大家。
好，感谢高波女士的精彩分享。他刚才讲到与法国合作建立的中法低温计量科学与技术国际联合实验室，成功研制了高精度的基准级测温装置，提升了我国在低温温度测量及量值溯源方面的创新能力，为全世界为全球科技界贡献了准确的温度数据，展现了国际合作在科学发展中的巨大价值。特别感谢女士的分享，高女士的分享。接下来我们有请王栋女士，她是外交学院亚洲研究所讲师，研究领域是国际法与国际关系、技术外交。她将为我们带来关于科学向善与可持续发展的宝贵见解，请大家聚焦聆听。
谢谢主持人，也谢谢各位来宾，非常荣幸有这个机会和大家交流汇报。关于我们本次圆桌对话的主题是促进科学向善，助力可持续发展，我想结合我的专业领域还有工作经验，从这个国际关系、国际形势如何影响科学外交，还有如何从民间团体尤其是青年团体这个角度来促进就是科学向善包括可持续发展这么一个主题来进行交流和汇报。我们知道科技外交是当前国际政治中一个非常重要的领域，就像刚才主旨演讲中薛兰院长他提到的那样，中美竞争或者叫就是外交领域的影响对科技领域的发展已经起到了非常大的影响作用，一定程度上甚至是负面作用。就是围绕当前最重要的像先进半导体、生成式人工智能、包括量子计算还有这个生物技术这些关键技术领域的大国之间的竞争跟合作，已经怎么讲叫我们主导了或者是当前科技外交中一个非常重要的议题领域，叫重中之重吧。但是呢，一方面在这个俄乌冲突包括像大国博弈还有地缘政治紧张局势不断加剧的国际背景下，就是各国之间 它的竞争已经大于了合作，就是两种力量，我们讲分的力量还有合的力量。这个分的力量我们在国际关系领域可以讲叫高度政治，高度政治领域一定程度上已经挤压了像经济科技这种低度政治领域的发展，或者叫主导了它的发展。这是一个我们讲它是亟待更加包容公正的治理理念还有治理体系来对出现的就是这些像这种先进式这个生成式人工智能的一个技术滥用，包括像竞争还有治理的失序这些问题一个很好的规制。然后另一方面呢，就是我提到的这个核的力量，像所有的这种关键技术领域，尤其是生成式人工智能还有像先进半导体的它的产供应链的全球化分布，这些特性都决定了对全球科技问题的治理也好监管也好包括发展也好，它都不是一家的问题，它都不是一个国家，哪怕你再发达，在这个产供应链中居于怎样的一个中心地位，都很难摆脱掉，或者都很难脱离其他国家进行一个独立的发展。所以这个核的趋势也要求我们做更多的，不管是在这个高度政治的这个政府间，还是我们讲叫民间团体的这种企业间，或者是智库、高校，包括青年团体间，进行这样的合作跟治理。那我所在的这个外交学院的亚洲研究所，我们同时也是就是中国跟东盟国家的国家级这个二轨或者叫1.5轨的这个智库的国家级协调单位。我们在2022年的时候就曾经就是跟那个东盟国家共同举办过一个叫防震减灾的国际合作论坛，这中间包括像去年8月的时候，我们也是亚研所和这个中日韩秘书处和这个成都市外办共同举办了中日韩青年峰会。这次峰会呢是吸引到了100名就是中日韩三国的青年学生来共同到北京到成都来参与我们的一些学术交流活动，促进科学向善就是我们其中的一个主题。然后学生就是围绕这个问题从不同国家的立场，从他感兴趣的切入的领域，然后进行了非常有益的交流和发言。就是像这种就是学者间的或者1.5轨间的包括青年团体间的交流跟合作，其实是一定程度上从民间领域比较好的就是促进我们讲这种交流跟合作，以民促官的带动科技外交的发展，这是一个非常重要的领域。包括像我们今天的中关村论坛，我知道在座的有很多就是学者，然后也有企业政府间包括外交领域的就是人士，大家不同的身份但是共聚一堂来进行这种交流跟合作，本身就对我们今天提到的这个科学向善，对我们讲扩大低度政治领域，扩大就是科学经济然后青年团体教育领域这些领域方方面面的合作，来带动最终我们期待的这种科技共同体或者叫命运共同体的发展。所以我非常感谢这次活动的举办，然后也希望之后会有更多的机会就是邀请大家或者是跟大家一起进行这种学生间的跨界的然后跨国的交流与合作。谢谢大家。
好，谢谢王东女士的精彩发言。她讲到了科技外交是国际政治中的重要的议题，那么关键技术竞争和合作也是大国外交中的重中之重，民间外交和多边主义对话呢，也是推动科技外交促进共同发展和可持续发展的有效的途径。相信他的见识和经验将对我们的工作产生积极的影响。那么接下来我们还想请各位专家每个人用1-2句话简单分享一下关于促进科学向善助力可持续发展的未来的愿景。请各位专家依次发言，非常感谢您的支持和配合。
Okay, thank you very much. And giving the opportunity, so I will say that in the recent times, as the all the countries and global world is the world is facing difficult challenges, and one country cannot solve the problems of the development of science and technology.And we need to join hands together and for the development of, because I'm a doctor, so as we saw during the pandemic, so one country could not face the, solve the problems of this pandemic. So during the pandemic, all the countries joined the hands. So I think with the passage of time, as there are new pandemics and the new diseases, we can face in the future. So in order to have this global, to overcome the global challenges, we need to join hands and forget our races, forget our the nationalities, and we need to join hands together and be a one advanced platform for the development and for safeguarding the future of our generations. Thank you very much.
I will continue with Shaba's speech that we really need to join hands, and I quite agree with Ora Kanoke's speech that all the young people has to come together under one platform where knowledge sharing is very important, because as a scientist that knowledge sharing is so important that we can proceed to do open science work easily. And this will promote to SDG, sustainable development in long term. So all of us come together, put our hands together, and this is what we are looking forward towards, how science, open science, without border, it's very important. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. I think we will talk the same topics because you talk about the sustainable development challenge. So from the agriculture, maybe in other topics, maybe it's a little different. But for agriculture, I think it's very, very important, especially according to the climate change and also the limited of resources. So no way, no retreat now to find a good solution to solve all of this problem, especially for the cereal crops. You know that the hangers all over the world depends on the cereal crop and the main crops. So how can to be promote and define the solution? We need a lot of topics. And I think the promoting science and the supporting this sustainable, especially for science and the diplomacy, is very important now. So we need to be all together gathering to have one topics and one progress to increase these areas, especially in the intelligent artificial. We can complete this by using the agriculture and the greener societies. And I hope all the world focus on this point to keep the world safe, especially the food security for all the people is very, very important. And thank you very much.
希望未来和国际同行一起以更广阔的视野，然后呢，构筑呢更和平发展的这样的环境，共同促进就是人类的科技进步。谢谢。我想呢，科技外交它的希望应当是在民间，在青年团体，尤其是。 像现在的这个国际形势，这种泛政治化、泛安全化的趋势，一段时间内，甚至相当长的一段时间内，是一个很难改变的。那我们可以通过在青年教育领域，像我刚才发言中提到的，包括像孙司长在主旨演讲中提到的，就是多边主义的力量，促进不同群体交流跟合作，这是我想一个非常有意义的渠道。谢谢大家。
好，谢谢各位精彩的发言。那么我们这次关于促进科学向善、助力可持续发展的圆桌对话就圆满结束了。再次感谢各位专家，请大家台下就坐。接下来我就会把话筒交给我们圆桌对话。